Good morning and welcome to our Good Friday service. I'd like to welcome everybody that's joining and watching with us and joining in with us this and worshipping with us this morning. I wanted to start by talking about hope today. A lot of you, as you've been walking around doing your daily walk, you might see all the rainbows in people's windows. And they're a picture of hope, a picture of solidarity, positivity, people coming together. Obviously, as a Christian, I think of our hope in God, rainbows to signify his promise and his faithfulness. But the Bible doesn't always offer easy answers or platitudes in difficult times. It does offer hope and it does offer truth. And I wanted to start this morning by reading from Romans 5. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance, and endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us, because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might, perhaps, be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, he will certainly save us from God's condemnation. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of his Son, while we were still his enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of his Son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God, because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. So this Good Friday, that's the verse that I came across really, and that's what I started thinking of. That chapter sort of up to verse 11 was where I was reading Romans 5. And God doesn't say there'll be no struggles or no suffering, but he does say that we'll have peace with God, friendship with him, hope and love. It doesn't mean rejoice because you have problems, but rejoice that in those problems, we know that God can use them to bring us closer to him if we allow him to. And rejoice that we're not alone. You know, when we go through problems and trials, we're not alone. He's there with us. On Good Friday, we remember that Jesus died for us. We remember that he came to take away our sins and to offer us forgiveness so that we can be right with God. And because Christ died for us while we were sinners, that's what it says in this bit of the chapter. Christ died for us while we were still sinners, and that he's given us the Holy Spirit and he's given us that relationship with God, and we've got hope because of the salvation that he gives to us. So I just want to pray and then have a time of worship. Dear God, I thank you so much that you brought your hope into the world. I thank you through the difficult times that you are still there by our side. You're still there loving us, supporting us, giving us your hope, God. And, you know, thank you so much for the salvation that we have through your son, Jesus. I thank you that you sent him to die for each and every one of us. Amen.
Step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. All days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon. Altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am. Good morning, all. I trust that you're all keeping safe and well. How quickly time passes. It seems just a lifetime ago that we ushered in 2020, never dreaming of the events that would take place around us. As I considered that, I was reminded of a story that had been recorded for us in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, and from verse 13 to towards the end of it, but we'll go only to verse 24. It concerns two men that were walking from Jerusalem to a little village called Emmaus, which was about 7-8 miles away. And they were having a little bit of a conversation. But let's read it, and I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version. Don't laugh, Bob. Now, behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And as they talked together of all the things that had happened, and so it was that they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained so they did not know him. And he said to them, "What kind of conversation is this that you have one with another as you walk and are sad?" Then one whose name was Cleopas answered and said unto him, "Are you only a stranger in Jerusalem, and have you not known the things that have happened there these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And so they said to him, "The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and in word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned with death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he that was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, beside all this, today is the third day since these things have happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us when they did not find his body, and they came saying they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see him." I'll leave the rest of the story for you to read, but let's just do a little bit of eavesdropping here and try and imagine what their conversation was all about. In verse 14, we are told that they discussed all those things that had happened. What things? Well, where do we start? I suppose the triumphal entry into Jerusalem of Jesus riding on a donkey. Not the sort of entry that a conqueror would make, don't you think? It should have been on a white stallion. And the subject matter then changes as to how they heard that Jesus had been arrested and had appeared before the religious leaders and charged with blasphemy, and then taken and brought before the Roman leader of the area, Pontius Pilate, and all the trial that took place there and all the things. And I wondered, were they part of the crowd that were shouting? Maybe they had got totally discouraged. I don't know. We're not told that, but I'm sure that they would have wondered all about that, because what we can glean from the account is that they thought Jesus would be the one that would rid them of the oppressive Roman yoke. Disappointment and sadness that he hadn't lived up to their expectations. After all, they had heard and witnessed. Here was someone who not only healed people and challenged the religious leaders, fed the poor, even raised somebody from the dead. In fact, a couple of people were raised from the dead. They had not understood the fullness of his teachings. They had only seen him as a liberator. They didn't understand that he had come not to rescue them from the Romans, but to rescue them from themselves. Now, this man Cleopas has a rather interesting connection. We seem to think, and there is a little bit of discussion about this in circles, that his wife Mary is the one that's recorded in John chapter 19 and verse 25, and is one of the women that were involved in going, following afar off and watching the crucifixion, and then coming along and with the spices going to the tomb. And I'm sure that the likelihood of being part of the group of women that found the tomb empty, I don't think we're pushing the facts. But it would seem that Cleopas and his companion didn't believe the woman and decided that this was rather a lost cause, and so went home. But as they continued their journey, they were joined by another man who questions them about why they're looking so sad and the crestfallen condition. they were rather surprised that this man didn't know what events had taken place, as dramatic as they were. And so they tried to explain to him. And then they received a rather an amazing Bible study from this guy, because he started right from Moses and all the prophets, and he started talking. And it would seem that he was connecting himself to all this, but they still didn't understand. You see, I think it's because what they had heard didn't quite fit the concept of what they expected to happen. But I love the end of the story, because the man that joined them was the risen Jesus. How he came so quietly and obtrusively and joined them, that really struck me. We don't have to have a big fanfare meeting with Jesus. He simply makes himself known quietly and without great fuss. I don't know what your expectations of who this Jesus might be, or what he's able to do for you may not quite fit or be relevant to your situation. But as you walk this life's road, just allow the stranger to Jesus to join you and see and hear the most amazing things. He wants to join each of our life walks, because he said that if we just simply believe on him, he will give us life that will last forever. Now, when Cleopas and his friend realized who were talking to them, their lives changed. My, how dramatic. They went back to that city of peace, Jerusalem, and told everybody that they had met with Jesus. And while they were doing that, Jesus appeared to all of them. You see, we've simply got to allow Jesus into our very personal space, and then we'll see the dramatic change that will take place in our lives, just as these two men did. God bless you.
Good morning. We're going to share communion together now. It's really strange celebrating Good Friday and Easter apart, but it's good to know that we're still one body, joined in the fellowship of Jesus as we remember together. 1 John 3:16 says, "This is how we know what love is, that Jesus gave his life for us. This was the greatest sacrifice of love ever. His physical suffering was enormous. Maybe if we try hard enough, we might be able to just imagine a little of it. The awful pain of the whip, the thorns, the nails. But the greatest agony he suffered is way beyond our imagination. The horror of a holy God taking on the weight of the evil of all the sin of the world. The anguish of the breaking of that eternal relationship of the Father and the Son so that we could be restored. That was the agony that Jesus faced and overcame in the Garden of Gethsemane. And the agony that he experienced on the cross as he cried out in the darkness, my God, why have you forsaken me?' But he also shouts a note of triumph as he dies. 'Father, into your hands I entrust my spirit.' In the horror of sin and the agony of separation, he never doubted that his Father would receive him as a willing sacrifice and restore him. And he never doubted that his sacrifice was enough for us too. So as we share today in our bread and wine, let's give thanks for the separation he bore for us and the victory he's won for us. On the same night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Eat it in remembrance of me.' And he took the cup, saying, 'This is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink this, do it in remembrance of me. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Apart, we're still one together in you. Thank you this morning for another reminder of your body and blood given for us, and for the freedom we have to live with you forever because of your great sacrifice. Keep us living in the victory that you've won for us through this difficult time and beyond as we look forward to your return. Amen.